I think we all have three personas that we can identify in our life. We have a professional persona, we have a public service persona, and we have a passion persona. And this is something that captured me through my passion persona in a way where I said, oh my gosh, this is a story that has to be told. Whatever I can do to tell this story, I need to be involved. Consequently, it has given me such a context into the history of who I am and how we all share in the traditions and values of this community, represented by three of the core values of Texas A&M University, those being leadership, excellence, and selfless service. There may be other stories that compare to this relative to those core values, but I don't think that there are any that will exceed what its representation about those core values that have made not only our community strong, but they've made our country strong. And as you will see today, we're instrumental in keeping our world strong. So thank you for the opportunity, the Historic Preservation Committee. I know that y'all usually don't have a meeting in December. Thank you for extending this, particularly when we are celebrating the 71st anniversary of the Battle of the Bulge today. Those of you who know me know I have a significant passion about being an Aggie. I love everything Aggies are. I appreciate everything that they have done, and I look forward to what they will continue to do in the future. The energy of those young people who are on Texas A&M University's campus today is amazing, and I really look forward to what they're going to do as a result of their engagement with this community through Texas A&M. I guess maybe the best way to start, how many people are Aggies who are in the audience today? Okay, great. One other question is how many of y'all here have lived in this community for 20 years or longer? Outstanding. Okay, how many of y'all have lived in this community for 10 years or less? 5 years or less? Okay, welcome to the community, those of you who are the newer members of our community, because this is a story that I hope that those of you, no matter how long you've been here, will appreciate knowing more about. So I guess with that many Aggies in the class, in the room, I'm going to start off by saying, got a little story for you, Aggs. It's a story about timeless values, as I said. It's the value of selfless service and shared sacrifice. It's a story about the good in the world. It's a story that, and we need a lot of the stories about the good in the world being told today, don't we? This is that type of story. It's a story about a relationship that began over 70 years ago, a relationship forged in the heat of battle that can still be seen living itself out in a relationship between us and Belgium today. And that's actually what got this all started off. We need to understand and tell our story better, because to a great degree what we learned while we were over there was that the Europeans in many ways understand us, who we are, what we did, and tell our story in some ways better than we understand it and tell it ourselves. So we need to tell it like they do to the future generations of Americans, so that they will be able to understand the context of the time they now exist in. So thank you. I have to make a political disclaimer here, okay? No City of College Station or public funds were used to fund my trip to Belgium a year ago. Had to get that one out of the way. Okay, it was all personally funded. Everybody knows the adage about Texas A&M. From the outside looking in, you can't understand it. From the inside looking out, you can't explain it. Here's how former A&M President Bob Gates revealed his understanding of this concept when he became an insider. I've said since I arrived here at Texas A&M that it's a unique American institution. We need to get that message out. We need to be more aggressive in letting people know the extraordinary high quality of teaching and research that goes on here and the uniqueness of the university. What makes us unique? We have phenomenal world-class facilities. We have a phenomenal world-class faculty, researchers. But what is it? Do those things make us unique? Obviously, they're necessary to have the stature that Texas A&M University does have. But what is it that makes our community and our university unique? Spirit. Anybody else?
Values.
Loyalty. Okay, we're starting to hit those six core values again. Okay? It's our culture. And nobody else has what we have. We own the market on values, traditions, spirit, and that is a part of our legacy, and we need to make sure that it continues. There's a really great video on our website, and if you would pick up that little flyer that we put that Jill put out on all of y'all's tables, that will direct you to a lot of additional information, because it's a real challenge to tell this story in a brief period of time like this. But there's a huge amount of information out there. There is a great about 12 and a half minute video on our website that you can look at. That is Brett Cornwell, who is really the catalyst relationship between us and our Belgian economic development partners that came up with this. And I really strongly encourage you to look at that about 12 and a half minute video, because he does a better job of explaining things than I'll ever be able to. And who are the five Aggies? This is a exhibit in Bastogne, Belgium that has an Aggie flag hanging 500 feet tall in the middle of Europe, telling this community's story. We have five representative Texas A&M graduates who this is about, but they are representative. They are representative of all Aggies. They are representative of all veterans who not only have fought in this particular World War II theater, but the Pacific. And they are representative of what the history has directed us to become in our future. They are Turney Leonard, Joe Rout, James Hollingsworth, Willie Pena, and Earl Rudder. Willie Pena is the only currently living member of the five. He's 95 years old now. He was just recently made a distinguished alum of Texas A&M University this fall. There's some information there that I want you to look at too that talks about the relationship between what's going on in the biocorridor and economic development, other economic development things that are still impacting our community today. 71 years ago, the threat was something different than it is today, but the relationship of this partnership that was forged in battle then now is expressing itself as a relationship in vaccine manufacture for bioterrorist threats and pandemic influenza threats still today. So the challenge that we face on a global basis has changed, but the spirit of meeting and exceeding that challenge is still here today in the relationship we have between Texas A&M University, this community, and Bastogne, Belgium. A year ago today, let me let Jill give you a little run-through of what's actually in Bastogne, Belgium, and a year ago today, the experience that we all had. Jill?
Let me take this off of here. So, all right.
Good. You're good.
Everybody? Yes. So, Steve's touched on a little bit about how this exhibit came to be in Bastogne, Belgium, and as he suggested, this was really the Belgians' idea to create a museum to honor American service. And let's make sure I got this going here. All right, so the exhibit opened in December of 2014, and it all started in May of 2014 with a preview. This is the Martesson Memorial. It's outside of Bastogne, Belgium. It was built by the Belgians right after World War II to honor the sacrifice of Americans who died in the Battle of the Bulge. It's about 3 stories tall. It's an impressive structure. In the next slide, you'll see what they did with it as a preview to the opening of the exhibit, Texas Aggies Go to War. They did a huge sound and light show attended by 4,000 Belgians. I think there was probably one American there who happened to be Linda Raby, who works for the A&M system, who went over to see this. 4,000 Belgians attended to see this preview show for the exhibit. And Madeline's going to run a short little clip here. It's a 40-minute show, you can see the entire thing on the website, which is identified there on the flyer.
Yeah, I would suggest if you have a smart TV, go ahead and put it on your TV. It's great.
It's impressive, and I'm sorry that you couldn't hear the music, but it's all with this, you know, orchestral background. It's very impressive. It's really it. So December of last year, on this day, was the opening of the exhibit. And we arrived in Bastogne. We had a group from the community that attended the opening. And the windows of the town were decorated with American flags. And next slide. There's not many left, but there were a couple dozen, probably about 30 World War II veterans who attended that weekend. And that weekend is special because it's called Nuts Day Weekend. And in the next picture here, you'll see what they do. And that's why Steve put walnuts on your table. And I'll let Steve tell the Nuts Day story here quickly to orient you to why this is such an important weekend for the Belgians.
Thank you, Jill. Okay. Does anybody know what Nuts Day represents? Okay, a few of you do. It's great. When Bastogne was surrounded at the beginning of the Battle of the Bulge, General McAuliffe was the commander of the United States and Allied forces that were completely surrounded in Bastogne, Belgium. And the German officers came to demand his unconditional surrender. Okay, his answer to them, which really hung him up, was a single word answer: nuts. In Belgium, in Bastogne, every year they commemorate the Battle of the Bulge by having what's called Nuts Day. Okay, so you have a walnut here today, so you have now celebrated Nuts Day in Bryan College Station, Texas. Okay, who you see here on this picture is the King and Queen of Belgium, okay, at the City Hall balcony, throwing walnuts to a massive crowd. It's kind of like Mardi Gras, okay? It's amazing, but they're throwing nuts to this huge crowd that's just watched a really great military history parade that's gone by. So thank you for celebrating Nuts Day here with us in Bryan College Station, Texas.
Yeah, so that's the King and Queen of Belgium were there for Nuts Day and attended. They came to the Texas Aggies Go to War exhibit for the opening, and that's the Prime Minister of Belgium. That's the Prime Minister of Belgium and the Mayor, the one on the far left. When you're looking at it, that's the Mayor slinging a nut out there too. All right, in the next slide, so I'm going to give you a little walkthrough of the exhibit itself. This is the first room that you enter, and the floor is an illuminated seal for Texas A&M University. And there's a 5-minute video clip that runs telling the history of Texas A&M and leading all the way up to today and A&M as a world-class research university. So the five Aggies, Steve introduced you to them by name. This is a print that was done by Benjamin Knox here in town of the five Aggies. They were chosen, as Steve said, representative of all Aggies and all Americans who served. So starting on your right is Earl Rudder. And everybody knows Earl Rudder, of course, for leading the Rangers up Pontahawk. But military historians say that he's really, his greatest military achievements were at the Battle of the Bulge. So Earl Rudder, class of 32, after the war came back to serve Texas and specifically serve Texas A&M, as you all know, as president who made historic changes in terms of admitting women to Texas A&M, changing the name to Texas A&M University and making the core non-compulsory. The next the next person over is Willie Pena. He's class of 42. Willie Pena was injured in the Battle of the Bulge. He lost his leg when he stepped on a landmine. He came back to the United States, and after years of rehabilitation, he completed his degree in architecture at Texas A&M and went on to found one of the world's largest architecture firms. He's still alive, as Steve said, living in Houston, and enjoys spending as much time as he can with A&M architecture students. He loves to come to campus and work with the students, and of course, they love having him here. In the middle there is Joe Rout. Joe Rout was captain of the A&M football team, class of 37. He was an All-American athlete. He was married. He had an infant daughter when he, in March of 1942, was called in to duty as an infantry officer. In December 1944, he was in Belgium at the Battle of the Bulge, and Rout heroically led his infantry company following the death of his commanding officer. And he was, for those actions, he was awarded the Bronze Star. And as he braved enemy fire to reorganize the company for a successful counterattack, Rout was killed by machine gun fire from an enemy tank after he did reach his objective. And then the next one over, James Hollingsworth, class of 40. During the Battle of the Bulge, Hollingsworth was injured. And he was actually wounded twice, and he was evacuated for medical care. But Hollingsworth was anxious to get back to his unit, and he left the hospital AWOL. He hitchhiked from Paris back to the Battle of the Bulge and rejoined the fight. He went on after World War II to make a career of the military, serving in South Korea. He served in Vietnam and in the United States. And by many accounts, he is one of the most decorated veteran military officers to come out of Texas A&M. And then Turney Leonard, all the way to your left, was part of a tank destroyer unit that found itself in some of the most brutal fighting during the Battle of the Bulge, actually at the Hurtigan Forest. And Leonard was wounded three times in the battle, and his unit took heavy fire. In the chaos, Leonard reorganized his men to fight and is credited with taking out six German panzers. Finally, an exploding shell shattered his arm, and he applied his belt as a tourniquet and was last seen heading for the field aid station. His body was found several years later and was returned to Texas. And Turney Leonard is one of Texas A&M's eight Medal of Honor recipients. So those are the five Aggies, and the exhibit walks you through their story. So it starts out at Texas A&M, and this is the Cushing Library that's been recreated in Bastogne. On the next slide, you'll see they even recreated the very detailed, beautiful ceiling. And if you haven't been in the Cushing Library, make a trip over there. This is on the second floor. And it's a gorgeous room. It's really worth seeing. The next slide here, they walk through the historical events, Pearl Harbor, and in the next slide, the reaction of the Aggies to the announcement of America is at war. And to put this in historical context, a lot of you are very familiar with this period in history, but the United States at this time had a small army, about 600,000. The Belgians had a bigger army than the Americans had, but A&M had remained ready and had been producing quality individuals who could step in as officers. And that's why you see so many Aggies in officer positions during World War II. This is a recreation of a recruiting room where the Americans would go and then find out what camp they would be sent to stateside. And in the next room, it's a beautiful recreation of a barrack, the type that Americans would have stayed in when they first arrived in Europe. It was perfectly done. Actually, some of the stuff in that last slide, the blankets on the beds, were provided by the Museum of the American GI here in College Station. And the next slide here is D-Day. So this is a recreation of the map that was used by the commanders to plan D-Day. Earl Rudder's helmet there. This next series of rooms takes you through the movement of the Americans after D-Day as they went across Paris, liberating towns one by one to Paris and then on to Belgium. And this is an interior of a home. And it explores some of the relationships that are still very important to Belgians that were forged between the American liberators and the people of the towns that they liberated. This room is sort of the family living room. And visitors can sit down here and listen to stories about the five Aggies, some of them told by relatives. Willie Pena, of course, tells his own story. And on the walls, there's pictures, and more pictures are being added, of other Aggies who served in the Battle of the Bulge, and a little bit about their stories as well. This room, you walk into a dark room, the floor is illuminated. That's the Martisson that you saw at the beginning where the big show was. And on the screen is scrolling the names of all Aggies, approximately 1,000, who died in World War II. And Texas A&M's, the A&M Silver Taps, is playing overhead. And believe me, nobody left with a dry eye. The final room is called the Partnership Room. And as Steve mentioned to you, this all came about because of economic relationships originally between A&M, this community, and the people of southern Belgium, which is known as the Wallonia region. And it's expanded now to a sister cities relationship. Linda Harvell and Dave, you're here, that are both involved with. And we're just trying, these are connections between our community today and the community over there. And in this room, on the next slide, yes, there's a Aggie ring. It's a big Aggie ring. And the Europeans are fascinated by the Aggie ring and the importance that Aggies place on their ring and connecting with other Aggies through the ring. So Steve is going to tell you a little bit more about this particular Aggie ring here, but it's a large ring. It was donated to the exhibit by the Association of Former Students. On the next slide here, as we mentioned, we have a website that that you can visit. And on that website, we've got more information about the five Aggies, the full story of each one of them, really great information. There's also a tab where we have some videos, and under press, we have linked the KBTX story that was done in February of this year. It's a 30-minute special that Steve Fulhard did. KBTX came along on the trip, and he did an amazing 30-minute special that will introduce you to this entire exhibit, also the background of the current economic relationships between our community and the Wallonia region of Belgium. So, all right, so I'm gonna turn it back over to Steve to tell you, there's so many great stories, but he'll tell you this one. We'll see if we have some more time, and some of you may have some stories as well that you'd like to share, but I'll let Steve take over and tell the story of the ring.
Thanks. Briefly, I would like to say there was a lady in most of those pictures of the opening of the exhibition. She was a very sharply dressed lady in a black dress with black kind of linked hair there. That was the U.S. ambassador to Belgium for the United States of America. I don't go to many things where the king and queen are there, let alone where the U.S. ambassador to Belgium is there. And I hope that that gives you a little bit of a significant feel of, there's really no way to explain what we experienced while we were there. But I hope that gives you a little bit of a feel for the type of esteem, regard, and thankfulness that these people still, 70 plus years later, their perspective towards us. We're all about telling that story to our people here so they will understand it too. That is the continuing mission of our effort, and we'll visit with you if we've got time about that a little bit later here too. But back to that, got a little story for you, Ags. Everybody's got a ring story, right? How many Texas Aggie ring stories have you heard? Okay? They're great. They're all great. This one is my personal favorite. We were talking about Turney Leonard earlier, and one of the five in the exhibit. And they found Turney Leonard's body after the cleanup of the Battle of the Hurricane Forest, but they never found Turney Leonard's ring. And a German lieutenant whose father-in-law was 15 years old after the end of the war, was his father-in-law's duty as a 15-year-old boy was to go out and aid with the clearing of all of the things left over after the war. And the Americans came in, they found the bodies, identified them, shipped them back to the United States. And after the American contingent had left, this 15-year-old German boy found something else. He found a ring. And he didn't know what to do with it. He talked to the people in the local town. They said, ah, just go ahead, just keep it. Okay? So he put it among a number of other things in a box in his attic, and it stayed there for a number of years. One day, his new son-in-law, who is a German military officer, was saying, well, what was the war like? And he said, well, you know, I've got this box up in my attic. Let me go get it. Okay? So they brought it down, and there were belt buckles and medals and, uniform and different things like that that the people had told him, you just go ahead and hang on to it. Keep it. Okay? But inside that box was a ring. And that ring, the young German officer said, you know, this would mean something to my family. This would mean something. This means something to me as a military officer. I need to find out what this is and who needs to get it back. So some of the NATO people that were working over there recognized it when he was talking with them as, oh, that's an Aggie ring. And so he calls up the Association of Former Students and says, hey, I've found this ring and I need to figure out how to mail it back to y'all so y'all can get it to whoever it belongs to. And he said, okay, well, you know, inside every Aggie ring is the name of whose ring it is. And he says, yeah. He says, and I've done a little research on that, but inside the ring it says Turney Leonard. And there was silence on the phone. And they said, you have Turney Leonard's ring? You're not mailing that back to us. You're bringing it back to us. And he said, well, look, you don't understand. I'm a German military officer. I don't have leave. I can't do that and all that type of stuff. And he said, let us get your contact information. We'll be back in touch. Okay. And not too long after that, Volker Lossner, who was this German lieutenant, got a phone call from his commanding officer. And he said, pack your bags, son. You're taking that ring back to College Station, Texas. Okay. In 2000, after 55 years of this ring being in his father-in-law's attic in a box. And now think about that. A gold ring that made it through all of the need for money or anything, never hawked, never sold, never melted down. It was there, it was preserved. That's a Spirit of Aggieland thing to me. That's really truly a Spirit of Aggieland representation. 2000, he brought it back. Turney Leonard's surviving family received the ring. The ring today can still be seen at the Corps Center, at the Sanders Corps Cadet Center over on campus. And they at that time presented Turney Leonard's Congressional Medal of Honor. Turney Leonard is in the Hall of Honor. If you've been to the MSC, you see all of the Hall of Honor, the Medal of Honor recipients. But that's not the end of the story. While this young German lieutenant was here, he became so enamored with what he saw and the relationships that he created as a result of this experience, his young son, who was 9-10 years old at the time, he got his Texas Aggie ring this year. You see the Lossners there, and you see Sebastian with his ring. And Jonas Lossner is Sebastian's younger brother to Sebastian's right. And he is currently enrolled at Blinn, and he's going to get into Texas A&M as an engineering student. So that's why this is my favorite ring story. I hope you understand. Why don't we give you a little bit of a kind of an idea of where we are now, what we're planning on doing, and how this goes forward. If y'all, you know, but any questions that anybody has at this time up to anything we've talked about? Yes, ma'am.
This isn't a question, but I wonder how many other World War II veterans are in the audience today.
Any other World War II veterans in the audience today? Right. Please stand so we can thank you. Thank you for your service to our country. Thank you for bringing that question up. I appreciate that.
Steve, who is that? What's his name?
Your name, sir?
John Atterbury.
John Atterbury.
John Atterbury, class of 45.
There we go.
Woo!
Okay. Sound off. Yes, sir?
You said he missed the polls by a month.
That might have been a good thing. Yes. And, sir, your name, please?
Charlie Seagraves.
Charlie?
6th Mary.
Yes, sir. Okay, and in the back?
John Standard, S-T-A-N-D-A-R-D.
Mr. Standard, thank you for your service to our country. Were you an A&M graduate? Which class?
41.
Class of 41.
Wow.
Yes, sir. 51. Okay.
How many Americans died at the Battle of Bastogne?
You know, I don't have that exact figure.
Let me see. Let me make sure that I tell you the right number. I believe there was 55,000 Americans died at the Battle of the Bulge, but I'm not quite sure. So the Hurtigan Forest is sort of the early stage of the Battle of the Bulge, and there's some people here who know a whole lot more military history, but the Hurtigan Forest started as early as October. What we know as the Battle of the Bulge sort of started in December and went into January, but yes, and from what I understand, from what the Lossners have told us, the Hurtigan Forest was even more deadly and bloody for Americans than what we know as the Battle of the Bulge. And that began in October of 44.
Thank you. Okay, well, let's talk a little bit about where we are today, because this we have viewed this as a three-phase type of project. First phase was to work with our Belgian partners, the City of College Station, Texas A&M University, the City of Bryan, and the Research Valley Partnership. All were funding entities to establishment of the exhibit over there, along with the Belgian investment partners. Those you will see if you go to our website, and you'll see who all had a part in that. And that was to get this there open and to be telling people in Europe who Aggies are and what they're all about. And I think they've done a pretty good job of that so far. Phase two, the exhibit closes down, and if you have the opportunity to go see it, there is a traveling Aggies that's part of the Association of Former Students trip. They coincided with us on a trip at the same time, and part of their trip was to be there for the opening of the exhibit also. But they've got another one coming up next year that you might want to look into, and it is it's called The Footsteps of Earl Rudder. And it goes all over the region and follows Earl Rudder's involvement there. And if you get the opportunity to see it over there, it's great. Yes, Lady Aggie basketball team. Coach Gary Blair heard this story. Actually, Sebastian and Volker Lossner told this story to a group that is called Blair's Buddies at a meeting in Texas A&M University's women's basketball team has a tournament that they're playing in Amsterdam August of next year, and this is going to be part of their tour while they're over in Europe also.
Steve, did you tell them about how John Adams and Henry Dethoff's book, Texas Aggies Go to War, preceded all of this?
Yes, this is material? good point, and I was going to give you, I don't have my copy of Texas Aggies Go to War. I've got a couple of other ones, but there are a bunch of great ones. Your Christmas shopping list, this is fantastic, okay, for somebody who has an interest in this. But the book itself is called, and that really leads up to where we are in phase two and what we hope could be phase three of what we're all about here. But John Adams and distinguished history professor Henry Dethoff wrote this book called Texas Aggies Go to War. Now, this book goes all the way from the Spanish-American War to Afghanistan. So this is just a little slice out of that was representative, that came up, and it was timely relative to the 70th anniversary of the Battle of the Bulge. Phase two is we're working, we set up a 501c3, a group of people, and we would like to see this exhibit in a different version or a similar version be somewhere here in the Bryan College Station community. We have some partnering interests there. The other part of it is during phase two, what we want to discern is whether there's the need for a phase three, because from this book that John Adams and Dr. Dethoff wrote, we can pull out any particular period of time for any military history anniversary that's being celebrated that we want to, and Texas A&M University and Texas Aggies in this community are so well represented in that aspect of what the Morrell Act created in the 1860s, post-Civil War for us. So what we want to do is start to make maybe a shift towards the 100th year of the of World War I. U.S. involvement would come up in 2017, 2018, and in what we want to recreate here, and we'd love to have your help in that as a community, what we want to do is recreate that and start making that transition into U.S. involvement. The Cushing Library has a phenomenal, did anybody get over to see their World War I back in 2014, their World War I exhibit that they had over there? What did you think of that? It's amazing, yet so few people in our community were able to see it. So we would hope to be able to continue with the Cushing Library, provided so many of the artifacts and things that we have here for this community to see what's there. So, excuse me, that works out in phase two, and as we explore it and recreate a shining example of the core values of leadership, excellence, and selfless service in this community, we would hope that there would be enough people who would want to see, hey, you know, we can do something about that all the time. Partnering relationships potentially with the Museum of the American GI, which if you haven't, how many people have been out to the Museum of the American GI? Great. Those of you who have not, it's phenomenal. Relative to the U.S. involvement in World War I, Brent Mullins is recreating probably what will be one of the only one in the world fully functional two-man Renault FT-17 tanks, and it'll be running. Another interesting part about that is the first, has anybody read Killing Patton, the book?
Sure.
Okay, there's a picture in Killing Patton of a tank, and it says first in Bastogne, if you remember from one of the photos in that book. Here's another interesting little story for you, Ax. It was the first tank that came in and broke the line when Patton's Third Army came up from the south to sever the German expansion trying to get to Amsterdam and liberated Bastogne. The tank was called Cobra King. And the guy who was the loader for that tank crew is from Edge, Texas. So, 3 years ago, I had no idea the richness of the history of this story, its relationship with our community, but the more I learn about it, Philippe LaChapelle, who is head of AWEX, who is the economic development arm that has the relationship with us here, I have given him the nickname Snowball, because as I have found out more and more and more the richness of our history that we exist in relative to this specific community just continues to amaze me. And we'd love to hear your stories. We'd love to hear your thoughts and ideas. And please go out to the website, take a look at it, and share this information about our phenomenal history and significance to the entire world from this community, and honor and celebrate those who served valiantly in keeping the entire world free. This will be something that the young people who are over at Texas A&M University today, who are like these five guys were, playing a game of basketball, studying for tests, watching a movie at the YMCA, their lives changed phenomenally, and they are no different in many ways in their perspective from who these five were or who the people who we've recognized here in the audience today for their service that was needed at a critical time and in the world. We thank you very much. Hope you have a very Merry Christmas. We will be around for questions, and thank you.